Most respected Yogacharini Meenakshi Devi, Ammaji, esteemed colleagues, I'll not name them one by one because the time is already running out, and my dear brothers and sisters. It's a great honor and privilege to be speaking in the city of Pondicherry, which my gurus Sri Aurobindo and the mother made their home, and in an institute named after the father of the nation, Mahatma Gandhi. It's a great confluence, and I'm very happy to be here today on the International Yoga Day to participate in this seminar. The topic is spirituality and modern medicine. Have the twain met? Before I go further, may I ask how many of you think the answer to this question is yes? And how many of you think this answer is no? So most of them don't want to commit. Eh? Most of you don't want to commit. Very few hands going up either way. Anyway, let's see what the response is by the end of this session. Next slide, please. I bring you from Delhi, greetings from Sri Aurobindo Ashram Delhi branch. And of course, this is their home, the love and blessings of the mother and Sri Aurobindo. Next, please. To establish the background, I'll just go very briefly over the recent history of modern medicine. Modern medicine made some spectacular advances in a very short period of just about 50 years from around 1900 to 1950. The antibiotics, vaccines, vitamins, the discovery of insulin, anesthesia becoming safe, X-rays, biochemical tests, which made diagnosis accurate. All this happened within a relatively short period of just about 50 years. And we were so overwhelmed by it and the results that it brought that we forgot some of the basic things which, in fact, ancient physicians knew very well. The result of all this was that those parts of the world which could benefit the most from these advances experienced a remarkable increase in life expectancy. And the history has repeated itself in India. When we became independent, the life expectancy was about 30 years. Today, it's more than double. So it has been the same thing, the same advantages which modern medicine brought in that relatively short period of 50 years that did it in the West, and it has done it once again in this country since independence. All that is very good, but people have started dying at an older age of a different set of diseases. And this was a humbling experience because the new killers of mankind did not lend themselves to the type of mathematical approach which conquered infectious diseases and vitamin deficiencies. In those cases, it was a clear-cut agent, a germ which was responsible, or the absence of a principle like a vitamin or a hormone. And therefore, we just had to find an antidote to the infectious agent or replace the missing agent. These diseases, the new killers of mankind, cardiovascular diseases, complications of diabetes, cancer, stroke, and so on, these diseases were a different kind of disease. Here the etiology was multifactorial. The roots lay in an unhealthy lifestyle, which basically meant eating too much, eating the wrong kind of foods, not having enough physical activity, putting into the body harmful substances like alcohol and tobacco, and above all, mental stress. So these were the root causes of these diseases. And using the scientific approach which modern medicine has, it started looking for better ways to, it started looking for healthy lifestyles and better ways to overcome mental stress. Both these explorations converged on the rediscovery of disciplines like yoga, which combine superb lifestyles with very potent, infallible, perennial principles for lasting mental peace. Next, please. So, in other words, modern medicine rediscovered yoga as a combination of a healthy lifestyle and as a stress buster. This is important to keep in mind because it didn't really look upon yoga as such a, just a set of physical postures. The route by which yoga entered modern medicine about 50 years ago was as a healthy lifestyle and as a stress buster. And let's look at these two aspects one by one. Yoga as a lifestyle, primarily still looking at the physical activity, diet, etc., sleep, adequate sleep, and so on, achieves fitness of the body and the mind. But then when yoga does it, as compared to, say, just doing it in the ordinary way, because you can do it even otherwise. A doctor might tell his patient, eat this, don't eat this, take a fork for at least 45 minutes a day, sleep so many hours a day, stop smoking, and so on. You know, he can do that. But how is it that these things are different in yoga? If we ask somebody a question, why do you want to do all this? He would say, to stay healthy, to prevent disease, to treat disease. He thinks that no further questions are necessary. But in yoga, we don't stop there. Why do I want to be healthy? What for? You know, just as it said that we became independent, but then another question we should have asked was, what will we do with this independence? So in the same way, yes, we have become physically and mentally fit using a healthy lifestyle, but what for? Now, yoga has an answer to that, because in yoga, health is only a means to a still higher end. The body and the mind are our basic instruments of action, and if they have become more fit, we will be able to do better whatever we have come to this world for. Which means that we can fulfill the purpose of life better if our basic instruments, the body and the mind, are healthy. And what is that purpose for which we are here? The purpose is spiritual growth or growth of consciousness. But for that also we need these basic instruments, the body and the mind. In fact, they work together. We might call it the body-mind complex. And if that is fit, we can do that better. Now you'll say, does it really matter in medicine whether a person does it for one reason or the other? Isn't it enough if he does it for staying healthy? It does make a difference. Why? Because if he does it from the yogic standpoint, then he has fitted this entire thing into a philosophy of life. He has a goal in mind, or rather a purpose in mind, to grow spiritually. Now this is a high goal. When we choose a higher goal, then many of the smaller things start falling off, which means that now he doesn't care so much for the taste of food, he doesn't care so much for many of the things outside, small creature comforts, sensory pleasures, and so on, on which our happiness normally depends, because now he has a higher goal in mind. Another thing that he discovers is that the spiritual growth comes from living a life in which choices are made not on the basis of the emotional part of the being or the intellect, but primarily on the basis of the deep inner voice emanating from our divine essence, generally called the soul. When he makes those choices, he finds that his life is full of joy and lasting mental peace. Which means that he finds that when he adopts a certain philosophy of life, which yoga embodies, then not only he becomes healthy because he adopts a healthy lifestyle, but he also becomes happy. Which means that to him, it is not some sort of a bargain. You see, when a person is doing only for health, it is a bargain. I'm not liking this healthy lifestyle. The previous lifestyle was better, but I have to put up with it for the sake of being healthy. The person doesn't want to get up early in the morning, but he says, I have to go for a walk because of fear of disease and death. He's eating green vegetables because the doctor has advised him to, but he's thinking of omelets and cutlets. Which means that basically, he is having some sort of a bargain. I have to give up an interesting and very pleasant lifestyle for the sake of living a little longer, for the sake of staying free of this disease, for the sake of treating my disease. Now, which means that he thinks that I have to adopt a dull and monotonous lifestyle for the sake of good health. On the other hand, when he adopts it from the yogic standpoint, he has fitted this entire lifestyle into a philosophy of life, he finds that now he's much happier. His life is full of joy and peace. And therefore he feels that this new way of living and thinking that I have adopted not only keeps me healthy, it also keeps me much happier. So for him it's not a bargain, it's a boon. This discovery is a boon. The disease was an excuse that showed him a path of life which made him not only healthy, but much happier, because now he's not looking for happiness in small things like the taste of food and other sensory pleasures, but instead he has discovered the source of happiness within. He has made himself independent of external circumstances. He is no longer dependent on external circumstances for his happiness. And therefore it makes a difference. And why is that important? That is important because if the person is adopting a healthy lifestyle and at the same time is not liking it, then the stress that he experiences because of not liking this new lifestyle can more than neutralize the good that physical activity and diet can do to him. And therefore, if he does it from the yogic standpoint, it does make a lot of difference, and therefore it does matter even in medicine. So this was yoga as a lifestyle. The next thing is yoga as a stress buster. The common perception is that yoga acts as a stress buster because it is normally associated with meditation. And it's meditation that relieves the stress. This is a gross oversimplification, as well as expecting too much from too little. If the person just sits quietly in meditation for 20 minutes a day, that will not compensate for the tension and turmoil of 24 hours unless he learns to look at life differently. Which means it is the change in the attitude that he has to life that relieves stress. Stress is primarily because of either people, interpersonal relationships, and now he learns to look at people in a different way. He's more charitable in looking at others. He can see a soul connection with them, and therefore he is full of love for all, although he may not like everybody, but still he can love everybody. And therefore he can take a more charitable view of others and look at his imperfections also in a proper perspective, and the result is that his interpersonal relationships start improving. The other source of stress are events that happen in life. Now, if he understands yoga, then he doesn't look upon events and circumstances of life as pleasant and unpleasant, but instead he looks upon them as conditions and circumstances that he has been given for fulfilling the purpose of life, which means he develops a dispassionate view of events and circumstances of life, and therefore he no longer is emotionally upset. And this goes beyond, in fact, the equanimity that may be achieved through philosophical indifference. Sri Aurobindo uses this expression, philosophical indifference, that can also achieve some sort of an equanimity. But spiritual equality or samatha or samatva goes beyond that. It's not just accepting everything without getting emotional, it is accepting everything with equal delight. Because it is a prasada, it is a gift from the divine, which has been given to us for fulfilling the purpose of life. And that includes circumstances which we perceive as pleasant and those which we perceive as unpleasant, and we need both these types of circumstances in life for fulfilling the purpose of life. If we had only one type, we will not be able to fulfill it. Because if we had only pleasant circumstances, life will become so interesting and entertaining that we'll forget the purpose of life. And if it is full of everything that we perceive as unpleasant, then we'll feel like committing suicide. Which means that we need this mixture, and that's why we get it. So, you know, this gives us a very dispassionate way of looking at the events and circumstances of life, and we can accept everything with equal delight. And that's why Sri Aurobindo calls it equality, not equanimity. This equality means accepting everything with equal delight. Next, please. So, basically, in modern medicine, yoga is a mind-body approach, which means whether it is the lifestyle or it is as a stress buster, we are basically working on the mind. And since the mind-body connection is very strong, when the person is happy, he also starts getting healthier, apart from whatever contribution the physical factors like change in the diet and physical activity and all that make. So yoga in modern medicine is basically a mind-body approach, and this way of getting integrated into modern medicine became much easier because coincided with the use of yoga by some enlightened physicians was also the emergence of the science of psychoneuroimmunology. Next slide, please. The father of psychoneuroimmunology was Norman Cousins, whose picture you see here, who was not a doctor. He was not even a medical scientist, but he was a wise and learned man. And when he came down after a stressful period with ankylosing spondylitis, a disease in which only 1 out of 500 people get cured, and he discovered that the doctors hardly knew anything about how to treat this autoimmune disease, by some sort of a simple calculation, and it was in fact a very simple question he asked, which doctors had forgotten to ask at that time in the 1960s, that if stress could possibly give me this disease, will not happiness be able to cure me of it? So simple a question. You know, we had forgotten to ask such a question. So he adopted this approach and literally cured himself through a combination of laughter and vitamin C. And then went about writing this book, Anatomy of an Illness. And then he started encouraging research on psychoneuroimmunology, and that's why today he's recognized as the father of psychoneuroimmunology. He was invited by the UCLA, in fact, to go and take up a professorial position there, a non-doctor, a non-medical person, being invited to do that just to be able to stimulate research in this area and to be able to guide people on how to go about it. Mind-body medicine, and if one were to sort of sum up the entire sort of philosophy of this mind-body medicine is that we are trying to use the powers of the patient's own mind to heal his body, heal his physical illness. Now let's have a look at, next please, how some of the pioneers who introduced yoga into medicine in this way did it. Herbert Benson was probably one of the first to do it. He was approached by Maharshi Mahesh Yogi for doing some research on yoga, on his technique of transcendental meditation. Herbert Benson was a skeptic to start with, but then finally agreed on the condition that even if the results are negative, he would be free to publish them. And once he did that and found that the results were positive, the skeptic now became a convert. Now, as Professor Anandakrishnan talked about, we need to convert people who are skeptics. But unfortunately, I find that in this type of gatherings, the audience is very small and generally consists of the believers. All those associated with the Department of Physiology, with CITER and so on would have come here. Because it is their department running, doing the show, most of the clinicians would be missing. Because not only they are skeptic, but they are not even willing to see if there is something beyond what they already know. They're not only ignorant, they're even ignorant of their ignorance, and they do not want to know more. They think whatever had to be learned has been learned in medical school, and here are some cracks and eccentric people talking about some funny things, I don't have to go and listen to them. That is their approach, unfortunately. And it is probably more true of this country than of the West today. Because in the United States, I have not followed up this literature for a long time, but even when I was, about 10 years ago when I was following it up, there were at least 25 medical schools in the United States, which comes to about 25% of the medical colleges there, which were offering at least an optional course on spirituality. In India, there's none probably, except maybe CITER might be doing it something by the way, by the side, but there's no medical school doing it. So that way we are behind the West in this area, although this is the place where this knowledge originated. But anyway, so Dr. Herbert Benson became a convert, and then he went on to establish the Mind-Body Institute at Harvard Medical School. Deepak Chopra started as a disciple of, again, Maharshi Mahesh Yogi, and then he's, of course, too well-known a figure for me to say anything more about him. Dean Ornish, he was going through an existential crisis even before he joined medical school, and then to cut a long story short, it was a discourse by Swami Satchidananda delivered at his house which showed him a new path in life, and therefore it was not surprising that after he became a doctor, he ended up doing research on a yogic intervention in heart disease. So in other words, these are three of these people, and like this many other pioneers, entered yoga and brought yoga into modern medicine not as a set of postures, not even as just a combination of a healthy lifestyle and a stress buster, although they did use that holistic aspect of yoga, but they entered it through the spiritual route, through spiritual masters. And of course, although I'm not a pioneer, so did I. I entered this field after I had gone into the depths of integral yoga of Sri Aurobindo and the mother. So I also entered this area through the spiritual route. Next, please. And therefore, it was not surprising that these people, when they started talking about mind-body medicine, the type of expressions they used. They said that lasting mental peace needs anchoring to the soul, which means that one can have lasting mental peace only if we are able to dissolve the conflicts between the emotional part of the being and the intellect. And these two will dissolve not by making a compromise with each other, but by choosing yet another third part of the being as a reference point. And that reference point is the soul. When they're anchored to the soul and start speaking in the same language, that is the emotional part of the being, the feelings, and the intellect, that's our thinking, when they start speaking in the same language as the soul, that is our divine essence, then we'll have lasting mental peace. They started saying that the contact with the soul helps tap or harness the infinite intelligence of the body for healing. Now, whether it is the chemical molecules, or whether it is living cells, or whether it is the body as a whole, or whether it is the mind, these are all manifestations of the same supreme consciousness. So consciousness does not just mean ability to think. Although the cell may not be able to think, but it can express that supreme consciousness in other ways which do not look to us like thinking, but that intelligence is still infinite. And that is how we can have an entire orchestra of self-healing mechanisms coming into play in disease and leading to healing. This, as a surgeon, Professor Anandakrishnan, I'm sure, is very well aware of, that when we give an incision, the surgeon does it with the full confidence that this incision will heal. But it doesn't heal because of the stitches that we put. That just brings the cut edges close together. What heals the wound is that orchestra of healing, self-healing mechanisms which restore the skin to almost as good as new. And this is something which we don't fully understand. But this is an expression of that infinite intelligence that is packed into the body that not only works locally, but that message going from that cut wound involves so many parts of the nervous system and the endocrine system and the immune system to be able to ensure that that wound will heal properly. So that is what they started saying. The third thing that is stuck, please, previous one, please. The third important sort of facet of mind-body medicine is that mind-body medicine is just the use of one mode of consciousness to heal the disorders of the other, which means that the connection between the mind and the body is not really surprising to a person with some spiritual knowledge, because he can see that the body is a gross manifestation, whereas the mind is a subtle manifestation of the same supreme consciousness. So it would be surprising, if the two were not related and connected, if one could not act on the other. And therefore, if we can use the powers of the mind to heal the body, it is something only to be expected. Next, please. Now, let's go a little beyond mind-body medicine. Mind-body medicine uses the powers of the patient's own mind to heal his own body. But can the power of the doctor's mind or somebody else's mind, of somebody who loves you, somebody who wishes you well, can the powers of his mind also be used for healing the patient's body? Now you would say, well, now the old man is going nuts. Huh? This can't be possible. This can't be scientific. Huh? But if you just bear with me and listen attentively to what I say here from now onwards, you might start thinking a little differently. Next, please. And for that, I'll have to digress a bit to what actually spirituality is. Spirituality means that what spirituality tells us is that this world is not an accident. It was the result of the will expressed by this Supreme, the Creator, whom you may call the Infinite or the Absolute by any name. And Vedanta also says that the Creator did not really create the creation, it became the creation. Which means that the creation is a manifestation of that Creator. The creation is nothing but that Creator in another form. From which follows the third item, that since the creation is nothing but the Creator in another form, the Creator has an all-pervasive presence in its creation, and it is this presence, since it is not very obvious, we call it the spirit of the Creator. And it is from this spirit of the Creator, which is all pervasive, that we derive the word spiritual. And further, the Creator is not acting like an absentee landlord. Having created or having become the creation, he has not abandoned us and left us to our own devices. He continues to play a role in running this universe. And that human beings have a unique place in the universe, or at least on this planet. And the purpose of human life is to live life in such a way as to become more and more aware of the presence of the Creator, that is, there is a Creator, to become more aware of it, of that Creator, and to see its presence in everything, and to see its seen or unseen hand in all happenings. So this is becoming more and more aware of something which mental consciousness does not normally allow us, which means to go beyond the mental consciousness is the purpose of human life. And from this I have picked out only two items which are more relevant to what today's discussion is, that is that the creation is a manifestation of the consciousness of the creator, which means that the creation is nothing but the creator itself in another form, and all creation is an expression of that supreme consciousness. It expresses a small fraction of the consciousness of the supreme, and the rest is hidden. And that the creator has an all-pervasive presence in the creation, and that is what we call the spirit. So these are the two points that we'll be making use of in this discussion. Next, please. From this point of view, what is an individual person then? An individual person is a selective concentration or condensation of the spirit, which means the spirit of the creator has an all-pervasive presence, but within that there are individual condensations or concentrations which we call an individual. That is, that spirit gets condensed into a physical form and acquires a certain shape, but actually the individual is not clearly separated from the rest of the creation, which means that between me and this stand and the air and Ammaji, we see so much of a gap and so many things. But then these are all different types of expressions of that same supreme consciousness. Actually, there is no gap. There's a continuity. It's just that the forms that they've taken, someplace a solid wood and someplace a gas like air and someplace an individual with a certain boundary, which is the boundary of my body, my gross body or Ammaji's body. Huh? So basically, there's no breach of continuity. And if there's no breach of continuity, it means that this separation, which we take as a lasting or final sort of truth, is only an illusion. Illusion means not that it is a fraud. Illusion means that what appears to be is different from what really is. So what appears to be is a final separation, but what is actually not a final separation, but a continuity within which there is a certain concentration which creates this idea of separation. And in the same way, there's a condensation also at the level of the mind, which creates an exclusive attention to what this particular condensation is. So that is what the mind of the individual is about. But the separation is not total. And since the separation is not total, from this follows what I was saying a few minutes back. Next, please. Which means that if we take these two individuals, A and B, A's mind, you know, the spirit is all pervasive, so it's shown by all those dots all over this rectangle. Now, within that, one condensation is A and another condensation is individual B. Now, A's mind is an exclusive concentration or condensation of that consciousness, and so is B's body, which is also a condensation or concentration of the same supreme consciousness, the spirit, which is all pervasive. And therefore, A's mind should also be able to influence B's body, right? So that is what we are talking about. You'll say, well, theoretically, it sounds good, but then does it actually happen? Next, please. Now, if this were to happen, one person's prayers should be able to help the healing of another person. Because prayer is essentially a healing intention, good wishes, my wish, my sincere expression, and approaching the divine for healing somebody. Does it really work? I'll not go into the details, but now there are enough studies in prestigious medical journals showing at least a weekly positive effect for the positive effect of prayer on healing. But then, really foolproof, flawless studies in this area just cannot be done. And one major objection which is difficult to overcome is that the person who is being prayed for feels that the prayers of my friend will help me, and because he thinks these prayers will help me, he heals. Which means basically it's the patient's own mind working on his own body. Now this is a difficult objection which is very difficult to overcome. And therefore we find this is one area where if you go down the evolutionary scale, the studies are more convincing than the studies on human beings. So, normally we say that human studies are best, animal studies are not so good. But here, animal studies are better. The studies have been done on rats who have been given incisions, and then one set of rats, their cages have been held by a spiritual healer for 15 minutes a day for 1 week. In another case, in the control group, that was not done. You find that if the cages are held by a spiritual healer for 15 minutes or half an hour a day for a week, the healing is much faster. Now, you may say that, well, the animal also can appreciate the extra attention that it gets from the healer, that love that he gets from the healer, and that's why it is the animal's mind which is acting on the animal's body. So we go down further in the evolutionary scale. There are studies done on the effect of prayer or intentions of an individual on the rate at which a plant grows. And you find that the plant's growth is also affected. Now, we don't normally think that the plants are able to think the way we think and realize and appreciate this love the way we appreciate it. But still, sometimes we feel that even plants may be able to do it. So let's go down further in the evolutionary scale. There are studies on primitive organisms like fungi and bacteria growing on culture plates and so on, and on petri dishes. They are placed at a distance, and a person sits at a distance and wishes that this germ should grow faster or slowly, or this fungus should grow faster or slowly. You find that it works. The results are positive. Then there, as you go further down, you have cell cultures. The person's wishes that the cells should divide faster. You find that the rate of proliferation increases. If he wishes that this growth should be slower, this growth is slowed down. This happens to normal cells. It happens to cancer cells. Studies like that are available. Go down further. Take only chemicals, enzymes and substrates in a test tube. The velocity of the enzymatic reaction can be influenced positively or negatively by the intentions of a person sitting at a distance. Which means that no matter where you look, whether it's a chemical molecule or a whole organism, these are just different forms of expression of the same consciousness, and the intervening gap also has that consciousness, and therefore this intention can be transmitted from an individual to all these systems, living and non-living systems, instantaneously, unmediated, which means does not require really a physical medium to do it, and unmitigated, which means that the extent of the influence does not go down with distance, whether it is at a short distance or whether it is a healer or a well-wisher sitting in New Delhi or Pondicherry wishing that a patient should get better in Pittsburgh in the United States. It makes no difference. So the person may be sitting in the same city or across the globe in the United States. It makes no difference because the effect is unmitigated. So that is how this transmission of consciousness takes place. Next, please. Now, these are type of studies which were stimulated by a person called Larry Dorsey, who is also an MD in modern medicine. And he, in fact, has divided the developments in modern medicine into three periods. He says, till 1950, we had a rapid and spectacular growth of physical medicine, that is, was era one. After that came mind-body medicine, which was era two. And then what has already started, but not yet become well accepted and mainstream, is era 3 medicine, which means that the effect of the healer's mind on the patient's body. That is era 3 medicine. I prefer calling it consciousness-based medicine because this effect is because of the unitive field of consciousness that unites the individuals, one with the other. And since the based on that continuity of consciousness, we can call it consciousness-based medicine. Next, please. And therefore, in consciousness-based medicine, love and prayers are therapeutic tools. Next, please. Now you may say, but do we have a scientific proof? Now please be attentive, as I say, because I will try to claim no more than what actually exists. Firstly, I have shown you already that scientific proof is available for the efficacy of healing intentions, but only for the efficacy. And observations are never wrong. However, explanations can be wrong. One of the explanations is available in the spiritual worldview that we have seen how. So I have tried to explain in terms of the spiritual worldview these observations. The observations are never wrong, but explanations can be. And the spiritual worldview is only one of the explanations. There are alternative explanations in physics at a level which I do not understand. But all the same, neither explanation can claim that it is more correct than the other. And therefore, the spiritual worldview gives at least one explanation for these observations. And therefore, since it gives only an explanation which is plausible but not proven, because you cannot prove an explanation, you can therefore, we can just say that the observations are consistent with the spiritual worldview. Now, this is quite different from saying that these observations have proved the spiritual worldview. They are only consistent, which means there is no conflict between them, because the spiritual worldview provides a plausible explanation for the observations. Okay. And why this limitation? Because science has neither proved nor disproved the spiritual worldview. And in fact, science can neither prove nor disprove the spiritual worldview, because the methods of the two are quite different. The methods of modern science are not only inadequate, but also inappropriate for dealing with this issue. They cannot prove or disprove the spiritual worldview. Next, please. But sometimes, you know, we get obsessed with the scientific proof in the modern world, and the results of this are, one, we misinterpret results. We say that these experiments have proved that the spiritual worldview is correct. They have not done it. They've only shown the two are consistent with each other. Second thing that happens is pseudoscience. In our excessive enthusiasm to show that spirituality really works, we say, here is a mantra. It was recited in front of the 10 patients, and they all got better. Now, just because, and then to show that it is scientific, what we do is we do 10 biochemical tests and 3 imaging tests on these patients, and ECG and EEG also. Now, we have generated so much of graphs and charts and figures and so on. That does not make it science. Huh? That by itself does not make it science, because the experimental design is flawed. So to have a flawed experimental design does not make it science just because you have collected data with expensive equipment and expensive biochemical tests. That does not make science. It still remains pseudoscience. So this type of pseudoscience also abounds because of this excessive enthusiasm. Next, please. Now, this type of things come primarily from spiritual enthusiasts of the type we are in this hall. And they have their own dilemma and ambivalence. And this is brought out by two contrasting approaches that they take. One, that spirituality discovered all of science long ago. See, these experiments are now proving it, but the spiritual masters knew it 5,000 years ago. But let's not forget that spirituality is not being proven by science. Yes, the masters knew it 5,000 years ago, but modern science has come to those conclusions which are consistent with those through a different route, might have added some depth and detail to those facts, but then let's not say that it was known 5,000 years ago, and therefore in some way spirituality is superior to science because of this precedence. Let's be just sort of dispassionate about it. But all the same, if this does indicate that we can assume some sort of a superiority in spirituality as compared to science because it discovered it 5,000 years ago, that precedence itself is enough to claim that superiority, if we suppose we assume that for a moment, then why the second contrasting instance, contrasting stance, which also the spiritual people take, that science has now proved spiritual truths. Why do we want something inferior? We said that spirituality is superior because spiritualists did it 5,000. If it is superior, why do we want a certificate from something that is inferior? Why do we want certificate from it and say that it has proven it when it has not actually proved?
It's a democracy. And so you need numbers. So the inferior are more in number, so they will prevail. That's what you have to do.
That's the explanation. No, no, it's very clear. So you see, this is therefore something which is not really justified. And let's sort of just stick to what it is and learn to think clearly and express what it is and what it is not clearly, instead of just jumping to something which suits our own bias. Now, here is the objection which scientists of the type who are mostly absent from this hall, I'm sure, raise. That the spiritual worldview itself is an edifice built on hallucinations of the mystics. That there was a creator, that there is an all-pervasive presence of the spirit of the creator and all that on which you built this edifice, that is something which was a hallucination, which means that they had an experience which did not relate to a truth. Now, the same thing could be said about what a scientist might say about a leaf. A scientist might tell you that this leaf, which looks like a green sheet of paper, is actually made up of thousands of cells. And I can question him and say, this is your hallucination. I don't see any cells, and therefore it is your hallucination which you are talking about. I see thousands of cells. What will the scientist tell me? I saw the cells under a microscope, which means that if I have to see the cells, I have to use the same method which this scientist has used. Only then I'll have the same experience as a scientist. Now, for this, two things are necessary. In fact, not only using the microscope, but I also have to have faith in the microscope, which means I have to believe that the microscope is not just a magnifying instrument, which means it does not just make look bigger in size something which is actually there on the microscope stage. I have to believe that it is only a magnifying instrument and not an instrument that manufactures images de novo. It is not something which creates pictures. There's something, the mechanism between the stage and the eyepiece, which creates pictures, beautiful pictures, and therefore I get the feeling that it is the leaf which is I am seeing. Actually, I'm not seeing the leaf. I am seeing the what has been generated by some mechanism between the stage and the eyepiece. It's creating pictures, which means that I have to use a microscope and I have to have faith in the microscope. Now, if I claim that the mystics' perception of the creator and the all-pervasive presence of the spirit of the creator is a hallucination, which is his experience, what will the mystic tell me? Exactly the same thing which the scientist says. If you use the same methods which I have used, you will also get the same experience. Most of us are unwilling to use the methods which the mystics have used. There are two basic elements in that method, which mystics across traditions have used. Across traditions, across periods of time, and across geographical barriers. Be it the rishis of the Hindu tradition, or the Sufis of the Islamic tradition, or the mystics of the Christian or the Judaic traditions. They all used the same methods. The methods basically have a combination of intense concentration and extreme degrees of self-purification. If we don't use those methods, how can I say that these are hallucinations? So therefore, a more scientific way to say would be, well, since I'm not using the same methods, I cannot get the same experience. So I cannot question this person's experience. I have to keep my mind open to it. Maybe if one day I use the same methods, I'll be able to verify it. That would be more scientific than saying that these are hallucinations because I don't see them. How can I see them if I don't use the same methods? So therefore, this objection coming from scientists is a most unscientific objection. Okay, next please. So finally, mind-body medicine and consciousness-based medicine were introduced to modern medicine by spiritually inclined physicians, which means that they came primarily from physicians who entered this field through spirituality, through spiritual masters. The efficacy of these approaches has been shown scientifically. These methods are effective. Methods based on these ideas are effective. The observations cannot be wrong. The spiritual worldview provides a plausible explanation, although not the only explanation for this data. Now, all this probably is enough to say that spirituality and modern medicine have met. Now, what I have done in this, I don't know how much time I have spent, maybe at least half an hour or so. What I have done in this period is to try and give you a very quick and condensed, conducted tour of modern medicine as it has evolved over the last 100 years or so. And we have seen that how it moved from an era of physical medicine, during which some of these ideas which were there in ancient medicine, even in ancient modern medicine, means as it was in the days of, say, Hippocrates. Hippocrates was aware of the mind-body connection, and there were some ancient surgeons and physicians, I'm forgetting their names, but I do remember at least our surgeons used to tell us that this surgeon said, I give the incision, but God heals the wound. You know, so there were doctors like that, even in this medicine, which we now call modern scientific medicine or allopathy. Allopathy is a misnomer, I avoid using that. But anyway, so in this system of medicine, there were people before 1900 who were not completely aloof to the mind-body connection or to the that factor X, which we may call God or the spirit or whatever, that factor X, which is important in contributing to the recovery of a patient. They were quite aware of that factor X. But that factor got eclipsed during the period about 1900 to 1950 because we got some very powerful tools like antibiotics. You give an antibiotic, you give chloromycin to a person with typhoid, the fever comes down within a week instead of going on for a month. These were spectacular results. You give smallpox vaccination, no more smallpox. You give insulin to a person, irrespective of what the person is going on in the person's mind, the blood sugar will come down. So we got some very powerful tools. And the result was that this mind-body connection and that factor X was forgotten. But actually, it should not have been ideally, because no matter how many vaccines and antibiotics we have, if the person's own immune system is weak, the person will eventually die. That's what started happening to patients with AIDS. All the antibiotics and the vaccines in the world could not save them. Which means that inherent self-healing mechanisms of the body, which are based on that infinite intelligence which resides in every cell of the body, that is completely indispensable. But all the same, because of these powerful tools that we got in that short period of 50 years, we forgot all these things. But then we were reminded of all these things through lifestyle disorders. And over the last 60 to 70 years now, gradually there has been a comeback of all those things. But then it has not really been a circle. I should say it has been a spiral. Because when today's physicians like Herbert Benson or Deepak Chopra or Dean Ornish or Larry Dossey or Bernie Siegel, when these people are talking about these things, they're not talking in the same way as Hippocrates or some of the ancient physicians did. They are talking about it at a higher level with a stronger scientific footing as well as in a way that is more deeply rooted in Vedanta. Both these things are there. On one hand, they are more deeply rooted in ancient Indian wisdom, and on the other hand, they are also better rooted in modern science, which itself has evolved so much since those days. So they are talking about it at a different level. So it's not really been a circle, it has been a spiral. We are back nearly at the same place, but at a much higher level. So that is what has happened during the last 120 years or so, since all these developments started. But the result has been, after a divorce with spirituality during the era of physical medicine, they have reunited and brought together again. Science and spirituality have met. Now, how many in this hall today now feel that the science and spirituality have met? And how many think that they have not met? So, still there are fence sitters. Quite a few think that they have met. Nobody thinks that they have not met. No, there are no hand met. But then those hands which remain straight down, neither wanted to say yes nor no, are skeptics, and I'm sure some skeptics are there. At least they have kept their mind open. Thank you. Next, please. Next question. So this is, I don't think there'll be any time for questions and comments because it's already 1 o'clock, but you can always contact me. The email is simple. RAM for Ramesh, BIJ for Bijlani. rambij@gmail.com. Next, anything else? Thank you.
So thank you very much, sir, for keeping us, spellbound and for helping us to understand the relationship and the connection between spirituality and modern medicine. But of course, the twains have met. May I now request AK sir to please honor Professor Bijlani ji with a memento for that beautiful connectivity that he made us see, for putting us on that spiral, not the circle.